Welcome back, everybody. It's time for us to move away from talking about poetry to talking about writing about poetry. So we're going to be working with the different documents. And this is the first one that we're going to take a look at. It's entitled Writing About Poetry. And there's different ways that we will go in and write about poetry. So this is just meant as kind of an example or a model about how to incorporate lines from the poem, little quotes, into our own thoughts and into our own words. So, step one is the basic annotation process that we covered in the first set of lectures about reading a poem and then reading another poem. Right? So that's there. Then step two is to draft your analysis. So the poem we're working here as a model is Aunt Jennifer's Tigers. So this would be an example. In the poem Aunt Jennifer's Tigers, the speaker is a niece or nephew of Aunt Jennifer who is dead. The subject of the poem is how the speaker remembers how Aunt Jennifer had an unhappy marriage and would embroidery scenes on cloth, such as the tigers the poem is about. This leads to the theme of the poem, which is that even though someone may feel trapped in a bad situation, he or she can escape through the imagination, such as by creating household works of art. Right, so this is what we start with here. Now, the next thing that we want to do is we want to squeeze it down. Reason being, the first time we draft any idea, it's going to be really wordy. And you'll see the importance, the significance about eliminating wordiness and being really tight in our writing as we start to move forward and take a look at some examples of the essays that we'll be working with. So we're going to take these 87 words and squeeze them down. Now watch what happens as we do this. We're not going to lose any part of our idea. Any part of our idea as we do this. The speaker of Aunt Jennifer's Tigers, so you notice we don't need to have this. In the poem Aunt Jennifer's Tigers, the speaker, so we can flip this out because it's known that Aunt Jennifer's Tigers is a poem. We don't need to identify it. The speaker of Aunt Jennifer's Tigers is a niece or nephew of Aunt Jennifer who is dead. The speaker remembers Aunt Jennifer's unhappy marriage and her embroidery, such as the tigers in the poem. This yields the theme that even though someone may feel trapped in a bad situation, he or she can escape through the imagination, even by creating household works of art. So, we're off to a really strong start here, right? This is our analysis. So everything here comes from me, right? So now, step three is really, really important. Without step three, you cannot have successful literary analysis of any type. Reason being, this is my claim, right? This is my claim. This is my supposition about the poem Aunt Jennifer's Tigers. Now, what I need to do next is I need to come up with evidence to support my claim. What do I need to come up with? Evidence to support my claim. And evidence comes in the form of quotes from the poem. I'll say that again. Evidence comes in the form of quotes from the poem. And without those quotes, I don't have evidence. And if I don't have evidence, I don't have support for my claim. And then guess what happens to my claim? Exactly, everything tumbles apart. So, I have to go back and reread the poem And I want to look for brief quotes to support my analysis. Now, these quotes have to be brief because I cannot copy-paste big chunks of the poem into my work because that would displace my work and it would overpower my own thoughts and my own ideas. Now, a lot of writers of literature, when they are start to work with textual sources, they forget that the most important thing in any type of literary analysis is your thoughts and your words. This is your own analysis is what's driving the car, right? So you cannot let those supporting materials overpower your analysis. So now let's take a look at adding in the quotes and what we come up with next. Okay, so I've zoomed in a little bit here. I'm going to put my coffee cup down so we can start to really get into the nuts and bolts and see how this is done. Now, from that previous analysis, we're going to add in our evidence. The speaker of Aunt Jennifer's Tigers is a niece or nephew of Aunt Jennifer who is dead. The speaker remembers Aunt Jennifer's happy marriage, which is shown by, right? Now, here's my quote. It's very, very, very important to make sure that you have those brief quotes and they're built into your analysis, your sentence. Please remember, do not allow a quote to stand alone. It must be part of a sentence. So you can see that right here. Right, so here is my claim. The speaker remembers Aunt Jennifer's unhappy marriage. Prove it. Where in the poem do we see that? If I can't find the evidence, I can't make that claim. Which is shown by, right? So which is shown by. So that's leading the reader into the brief quote. The massive weight of Uncle's wedding band. So now you'll notice, right? Open the quote, close the quote, and then we must have that. That is the citation. Now, with poetry, what you put for the citation are line numbers. So this lets the reader know that that brief quote came from line 7, which is shown by the massive weight of Uncle's wedding band and her embroidery, such as the tigers. Right, so here again, it's part of the sentence. Bright topaz denizens. Look at that. Yes. In the poem. This yields the theme that even though someone may feel trapped in a bad situation, he or she can escape through the imagination, such as by creating household works of art. The tigers in the panel that she made will go on prancing, proud and unafraid. So with all of these quotes, right, we can go in and we can identify these different elements. We must have quotation marks in closing that brief quote. In addition, we must cite the line numbers. And as always, please remember that quote is part of the sentence that contains that analysis. That quote is the evidence for the analysis. Now, here, you'll notice something different. And it's the slash. What we use the backslash to indicate a line break. You remember when we, in the earlier lecture, we talked about stanzas, right? Stanzas composed of lines. And sometimes when you have a quote, you'll start with one line and then continue to the next line. So in order to show the line break, we need that slash. So that is used to show a line break. And then look, 11 through 12. So that fits, right? Here I have a line break. So that means that this first part, that this was line 11, and the second part, line 12. Now, a fun thing to do is to look in the poem and then make sure that everything matches up. So when you say lines 11 through 12, it indeed, in the poem, lines 11 through 12, line 2, line 7, and so forth. All right, so now here we have 117 words. This right here is our target. This is what we need to do. We have a claim, an idea that comes from our own thoughts and our own words, and then we have to come up with the evidence in the form of quotes, right? They work together. Anytime you make a claim, you have to have evidence, and you have to have analysis. That analysis is where you're going in and you're discussing and you're making connections for the reader. What does analysis do? Makes connections for the reader. All of this happens together. So now, some quick tips to kind of summarize some of the different elements that we covered here. Never drop a quote to stand by itself. Attach it to a sentence. Do not allow a quote to stand alone. It must be part of a sentence. B, as needed, explore the meaning of the quote. So in other words, you just can't copy-paste, and expect the reader to come up with the analysis. That is your job as the writer, is to come up with that analysis. When you add a quote, follow with the line number from the poem. Put this inside of parentheses. If your quote contains a line break, indicate this with the backslash. So, learning how to write about poetry. So we'll continue and pick up some new ways to write about poetry in the forthcoming lectures.